Does your computer struggle to keep up with your stream because it's being tasked too hard because it's not properly balanced between performance and quality on OBS, Streamlabs, or Stream Elements? Don't worry, in this video right here, I'm gonna show you the best tips and tricks to make sure you get that perfect balance so that way you can have the best quality on your streaming platform. And we're getting started right after this. Looking to upgrade the production value within your stream? Look no further than owned.tv. From overlays to alerts to stinger transitions to emotes, Owned3D has got you covered from beginner to professional. Simply find a graphic or design that fits your style and flair for your stream. And before you purchase, you can see how it will look with their interactive showcase. It's time you became bigger and better by heading over to owned.tv by clicking in the links below. Okay, I will be the first to admit, when I first started streaming, I was super lost within OBS, Streamlabs OBS, XSplit, and Stream Elements. Whatever broadcasting software service you use, they were all confusing because nobody taught you the proper way to get the best performance or get the best quality or even a balance between the two. And if you don't, you end up with a laggy stream or pixelation, or you're just dropping frames, which is really gonna negatively impact your viewer growth, your viewer retention, or you're just not gonna get anybody that stops in your stream at all. But lucky for you, I compiled a list that'll work for every single streamer out there that's gonna improve the balance between quality and performance. So strap in, cause here we go. If you're a brand new streamer out there and you consider yourself a noob and you're completely lost on how to do everything with streaming cause you're just dipping your toe in, by the way, welcome to streaming. It's gonna be a grind. It's okay because a lot of brand new softwares coming out or new additions to softwares have an auto detect feature. All you gotta do is turn this on and it'll run through your machine and internet and see what it's capable of producing for which platform you're gonna be pushing out to. And this is a great place to start if you're just starting out because you may not know what your machine or internet is capable of. Now, if you're beyond the noob phase and you've upgraded yourself to a scrub, awesome. One of the things you should do is take a look at what your internet speed is. We all get consumed with what our down is, but what's more important is actually your up speed and your ping. Upload speed is one of the most important things because when you broadcast, you're taking all of your video and sound, rendering it in real time within that software, and then it has to push it out to a streaming platform, which means it requires a lot of processing power and a good amount of internet. And when you run a speed test and your speed is a lower number than what your fixed broadcast is out, you're gonna get a lot of drop frames, stuttering, and disconnects. So when you run that, check what your number is and broadcast just slightly below it, okay? Now for an extra bonus tip, I recommend checking out your speed multiple times a day and do that for a good like week or so. See what it is in the morning, the afternoon, and at night. Because you will notice fluctuations. And whatever the lowest number is, if it's around that stream time, is what you kind of want to leave your benchmark at. If your ISP sucks, one of the biggest culprits that a lot of people overlook for the first investment to their stream is their modem and router. You may be surprised, you're probably on a rented modem that doesn't produce or bottlenecks a lot of the internet coming in because it's not really made for streaming on an upload scale. It's meant for watching, you know, Netflix or Hulu, Disney Plus now, or playing video games. They're only concerned about with the down. So investing in a better modem and router that doesn't bottleneck as much to your computer is gonna open up the bandwidth that much more, allowing you to push out higher quality content. While there has been significant changes in the technology of Wi-Fi, it is still recommended to be Ethernet directly in from your modem and router to your PC. So that way you minimize the amount of hiccups that can happen during Wi-Fi, because you have to remember, within this day and age, there are so many devices that are going to be fetching information from your Wi-Fi router that there could be a hiccup that can cause frame stutter or even make your broadcasting service just disconnect altogether. So it's better to have a nice Cat 6, 7, or 8 cable directly connected into your machine. Sticking with the whole internet and kilobit rate thing, which is an important part of broadcasting softwares, is the new introduction on platforms like OBS and Streamlabs OBS of dynamic bit rate changes. Before, when you had a fixed kilobit rate that you try to push up, if your internet couldn't keep up at that or went below that, that is where you'd have a lot of frame dropping, which was kind of a detriment for anybody coming in new to your stream. Now with dynamic bitrate, it'll actually lower the resolution a little bit. It'll give you a little bit of a mosaic or pixelated look, but it'll still keep a fluid stream. And once your internet can ramp back up, it'll dynamically change it back to that fixed rate, thus not causing any type of stuttering or frame dropping within your stream. One of the biggest mistakes I see brand new PC streamers make, that's as in your streaming from your PC, is the introduction of adding way too many asset scenes, sources, and elements, and widgets, whatever you wanna call them. You get really jazzed that you can put all these bells and whistles, but then you have way too many things on your screen, and you have too many things that are tasking your machine. Every time you add any one of these new assets, your machine has to work that much harder to produce it on the stream as it renders it and packages it and serves it up to the streaming platform. So if things aren't actually resonating with your community or audience, I would say get rid of it. In addition to this note is another bonus tip that we can give is if you're the type of person that creates a bunch of different scenes and sources, perhaps for seasons or holidays, don't forget to remove those scenes and sources or assets or elements or widgets again that aren't gonna be used, because every time they're included into the broadcasting software, it's still using that information or using that processing power to produce that information unless you've told within the software to turn it off when it's not being used, which most people don't do. So again, if there's any assets or widgets or anything like that that you're not using anymore, simply get rid of it, because that'll help free up resources. Since we're talking about scene sources, widgets, and all that jazz, in your source tray, which are those elements at the bottom of your broadcasting software where your scenes and sources go, grouping certain elements together can really improve the flow of your stream. When you transition from one game or category, you may be blocking certain important pieces of information when you're streaming a game or certain elements. And having grouped sources together, perhaps like your camera and camera frame or bottom anchors there, if you group them all together, you can move them into the appropriate spaces for where you will be streaming. So that way it's unintrusive, increasing the engagement factor within your stream, because you're gonna have a better looking stream. Talking about having a better looking stream, what really takes a task on your machine is the difference on how many pixels you're gonna be pushing out. And this is the great debate between 1080p versus 720p. Anytime you move from 720 up to 1080, you're doubling the number of pixels that has to be rendered within your broadcasting software, which means it's gonna take more processing power to actually produce that rendering of math to push out to the broadcasting software. Don't feel like you always have to broadcast at 1080p at a super crisp frame rate like 60 frames per second. 720p at 30 frames per second still looks really, really good on today's platform. You can set your standard to be 1080p, but you can have the output still be at 720 within your broadcasting softwares. And trust me, a lot of people would rather watch a smooth 720p stream rather than a clean, crispy 1080p stream that is nonstop dropping frames. If you're the type of streamer out there that's followed all the notes up to this point and you're like, hey man, my stream still lags hard and it has a bunch of problems, it's probably because your settings of the in-game features are way too high. You don't have to stream at ultra high fast shadings and cells and colors and saturations and crispness and details and all the bells and whistles out there. You can do it just, you know, moderate or high, and everything will still look very good. You have to remember, every time you turn all those super high settings up, it's taking more of your processing power from your GPU and CPU to allocate towards that game and less towards the actual rendering software of OBS and other broadcasting softwares, which means you're tasking your machine an awful lot. If you stream from PC that uses Windows in the operation system, is a great hidden feature that sucks a lot of free resources up if you're playing games. And this is called Game Bar. All you need to do is go to your control panel or the search feature and type in Game Bar. And at the very top, when it populates the settings page, is you can turn this off, because all this feature does is record game clips, screenshots, or broadcasts. But we don't need that because we're using OBS or Streamlabs OBS or XSplit or whatever you're using out there that does the same thing. So this would be running in the background and it's taking allocated resources that could be pushed somewhere else to make sure you have better performance and quality. So go ahead and turn this feature off. Speaking of background apps, why not turn off all the background resources and apps that you don't need for streaming? Even though these might be very small and minor things, they can add up over time to allow more free resources to be designated to the proper spots that they may need to be used at. And I'm talking about a bunch of different things. You could have background resources that are checking on your core temperatures or processing power, or even seeing how your CPU is running. If you're not using, go ahead and turn those things off or close them. Or perhaps you have multiple game markets open. Perhaps you have like Epic and Steam and Origin, but you're only streaming from Steam. Go ahead and turn off those other marketplaces because those will be fetching in information if you're not gonna need it. Same with like Discord. If you're not using Discord at that time, go ahead and turn it off. Now, I think we can all agree having bells and whistles on your stream is really fun and it makes you unique and it makes you stand out even more on platforms for when you're streaming. But a great debate that never gets talked about is MPEG-4 versus WebM. Now, a lot of people introduce new assets of GIFs, videos, or even slideshows of pictures through MPEG-4, which actually makes your machine use a lot more processing power to produce those quality of images on your broadcast and stream. But if you can convert some things to WebM, perhaps like Stinger transitions or pictures, those are such small files, it doesn't task your machine as much. So if you're the type of person that likes to show a lot of things on your stream via assets or images or video files, you may wanna see if you can convert them to WebM before even introducing them to your source trays. Ensuring that your machine is gonna have a great balance between performance and quality is huge because nobody wants to watch a laggy or frame dropped or off sync stream because there's so much competition. It's too easy to leave your stream and find somebody new, which is really gonna hurt your viewer retention and growth, which I don't want for you. I always wanna make sure you're gonna grow and look good on your streams, which is why I'm gonna put a video over here to the side that's gonna show you the Logitech Brio camera, which is a great camera to get you that extra crisp quality and beautiful saturation of colors for a web camera. I recommend checking that video out right after this one. Until next time, my name's Wild for Games and I will see all of you beautiful people in the next stream support video coming out real soon. Take care all and peace.